Well, hello and welcome to church. My name's Andrew McIntyre and I'm part of the Parks Baptist Church, and it's a pleasure to have you joining us today. I know that as part of this period of isolation, things have changed in our world. Things are different. For some it's in a small way, and for others it's in quite a large way. And one of the I guess one of the things that the thing that we miss the most in our family is not meeting with our church family each week physically. But this has been a way to bridge that gap some way. And we thank everybody who's been involved. I'm just a blow-in for today. I think we thank everybody that's been involved in getting this service in an online format each Sunday, pretty much from the time that we were told we could no longer meet. This has been able to run, and we're really appreciative of that. So please, if you get the chance in some way, whether it's an email or a text message or a phone call, the people that are involved in getting us together, please give them a thanks, because it really is a way that we can connect during this time of isolation. And I want to also encourage you that you'll notice at the start of at the service, or prior to the service, there's a chat line on the right hand side of the screen, and it's also at the end. Well, it's all through, but particularly before and after, just putting on a quick hello or hello church is a great encouragement to a lot of people who are logging in, many of them who may live alone or aren't able to get out as much as what they would like to. We all like that. It's a great encouragement to see people that they know are actually online and watching the same thing that they are. So if you've got a keyboard and you've got a finger that works, punch in a few words saying hello. I know that is an encouragement. But as I said, we're isolated at this time to keep our communities safe. And for us personally, it means that we're working from home. So behind me there is my computer, and that's where I've been working for the last 3 or 4 weeks. Our children, my children have been homeschooled. They're on holidays now and they're enjoying that, but missing seeing their friends each week. So definitely challenging times. I didn't think I'd be making a YouTube debut in 2020, but here I am. So, but in all things, we know that God is in control, that he has a plan, and that he has known that this is going to happen before it caught us unawares a month or 5 weeks ago. So we trust in him and give thanks to him for all the mercies and the blessings that he gives us now and always. So Matt, today we'll be starting a new series looking at the Ten Commandments found in the book of Exodus. And the Ten Commandments are probably one of the well-known parts of the Bible in and outside of the church. Whether you've grown up in the church or whether you've only been to church once or twice, if you've read the Bible from cover to cover or haven't at all, you've probably heard that there are Ten Commandments out there. And whether you can list them all is another thing. And I think we found that in the challenge last week. How did you go with that? Here, I got 9. I put together the first, you are to have no other gods before me, and you are not to create idols. I put that as one. So that was my mix up. And interestingly, Matt's speaking on both of those today. But I think this is going to be a really good opportunity to go through the Ten Commandments again, to understand them, because they are such a well-known part, because people are familiar in some ways with the Ten Commandments, that it's good for us to have a solid knowledge or understanding of the Ten Commandments, what they are and what they mean to us today, and what they meant to the people of Israel back in the time of Exodus. So I hope you enjoy this series that starts today, and as I said, I'm looking forward to it as well. Now, before Matt comes and preaches to us this morning from the book of Exodus, we're now going to have a time of prayer. So I'd ask that you bow your heads and join me in prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you, Lord, that you are in control of all things, that you know our hearts, you know our will, you know, Lord, our focus, our priorities, where our priorities are. And Lord, you also know our future. You know the current situation that our country and our world finds itself in at this time, and you know the outcome, and you know the direction. And Lord, in that knowledge that you know all things, we place our trust and our hope in you. And Lord, that we ask that each and every one of us, no matter how we are affected by this period, this time in our nation's history, Lord, that you would be with each and every one of us during this time, that we would be seeking your will and your wisdom and your comfort and your guidance, and Lord, that we would be strengthened in that. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, that we can come to you in this way. We thank you that through Jesus, who has paid that price for our sin, that there is no longer a barrier between us, Lord, that has been broken, and that we can come to you in this way through Christ. And we just thank you and praise you for that. Lord, during this time of isolation, we want to pray for our governments, for our leaders whom you have appointed to govern over us during this time. We pray, Lord, that you would give each and every one of them wisdom and guidance, and they would be seeking your will and your guidance for our country and for their governance, Lord, during this time. We pray that as a people of God, that we will be supportive and praying actively for our leaders, Lord, now and always. Lord, we also pray for our missionaries. And we think, Lord, particularly of Robin Green, who we've heard a little bit about today in Kids Church. Lord, we pray for Robin that you would be keeping her safe in Ethiopia. Lord, we appreciate that in many countries around the world, there are not the sophisticated health systems that our country enjoys, and a system that we can take for granted, Lord. And so we pray for all people in these places, but particularly, Lord, we bring before you Robin, and we pray that you would be keeping her well, that you would be keeping her safe, and that she would be able to, even in this, when their own school is closed, that she will have opportunities to spread the love of Jesus into Ethiopia and the people that she meets with and sees and communicates with in different ways. Father, Lord, I bring before you our pastor, Matt, and I thank you for his love for you and his willingness to serve you here in Parks. Lord, we pray as he begins a new series today from the book of Exodus in the Ten Commandments. Lord, we pray that you would grant him wisdom, that you would give him insights, and that you would be speaking through him today. Help him to speak clearly. Help him to speak faithfully, Lord, and help us to hear. Please take away the distractions and the concerns that each and every one of us has on the week that's been and the week to come, Lord, that we would sit, that we would listen, that we would understand, and that we would apply what you are speaking to us today to our lives. Lord, we thank you again that we can meet together in this format, in this way, during this time in our nation's history. And we pray, Lord, that everything that is said today would be for your glory, and that the honour and praise would be given to you. And we pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Hello, church family. It's Dan here. I'd like to lead us in some corporate prayer. So will you join with me as we talk to our Heavenly Father? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you're in control of all things. We thank you that especially at this time when things seem out of control, there is so much uncertainty, we recognize how little we really do know and that you are the all-knowing God. You are not only all-knowing, you are also all-powerful, and you are in control of all things. There is no plan B for you. What is playing out is what you knew was going to happen before the beginning of time. Heavenly Father, we just pray that the leaders that you have ordained to be an authority over us, that they will use wisdom at this time, that those who call themselves Christians in leadership we'll be following biblical principles. And dear Heavenly Father, as citizens, we pray that we too will be submitting ourselves under the authority of the rulers you've placed over us. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray that we do not get complacent as we start to hear the good news about flatlining and the COVID-19 virus not being as devastating as we first thought. We pray that we will still follow government guidelines, that we will still be thinking of others in terms of the transport that we undertake, the trips that we might be doing, that they only still be essential as per government guidelines. Heavenly Father, we just pray that we will continue to trust in you, that this is a wake-up call to us, that life is actually uncertain, that we are not in control, that you are in control. We pray that we will put our trust in you, that as we read through our Bibles, we can see time and time again that you were faithful and always kept your promises. We just want to thank you for sending Jesus. We thank you for his death and resurrection. We thank you for the hope of eternal life that we have because of what Jesus did for us. We just ask that you hear our prayers now and answer them in your way and in your time. In Jesus' name, amen.
This Bible reading today is from Exodus chapter 20, verse 1 to 21. I am reading verse 1 to 10. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall all have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in the heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold any guiltless who you misuse his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. His 6 days you shall labor and do all your work.
This is verses 11 to 21. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that they may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. When the people saw the thunder and the lightning, and heard the trumpet, and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses, "Speak to us yourself, and we will listen. But do not have God speak to us, or we will die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. God has come to test you, so that the fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning."
In Words We Live By, Brian Burrell tells of an armed robber named Dennis Lee Curtis, who was arrested in 1992 in Rapid City, South Dakota. Now, Curtis apparently had scruples about his thievery. In his wallet, the police found a sheet of paper on which was written the following code, sort of like a robber's rules. Number one, I will not kill anyone unless I have to. Number two, I will take cash and food stamps, no checks. Number three, I will rob only at night. Number four, I will not wear a mask. Number five, I will not rob mini marts or 7-Eleven stores. Number six, if I get chased by cops on foot, I'll get away. If chased by a vehicle, I will not put the lives of innocent civilians on the line. Number seven, I will rob only 7 months of the year. And number eight, I will enjoy robbing from the rich to give to the poor. This thief had a sense of morality, but it was flawed. When he stood before the court, he was not judged by the standards that he had set himself, but by the higher law of the state. Likewise, when we stand before God, we're not going to be judged by the code of morality that we have written for ourselves, but by God's perfect law. Let's pray. Dear Lord, I just ask that you would give me the words to speak and each of us the ears to hear. We just ask that your Holy Spirit would touch our lives. We ask this in Jesus' beautiful name. Amen. So I want to welcome everyone to the first part of our new Bible series based on the Ten Commandments. And I'm excited for us to be working through this topic in particular. I think it's going to be challenging. It's going to be a challenging time for all of us as we look closely to the words of God. As we work our way through the Ten Commandments, we're going to be breaking them up, each one into four sections. So the first section is going to be Revelation. We're going to look at what insight the commandment gives for us into the character of God. Secondly, confrontation. How does it give us insight into our own character? Thirdly, instruction, what the commandment means we should do or do differently under the grace of our God. And fourthly, the promise. Under the new covenant forged by the blood of Jesus and empowered by the Holy Spirit, we will see how God changes this law from being on a stone tablet or the book of a page to being written on our hearts. One of the first things that we need to consider while we look at the Ten Commandments is that these commandments were broken up into two key categories, you might say, and that they kind of like had a purpose in their order. The first three commands deal with the vertical or our interaction with God, while the remaining seven commands deal with the horizontal, how we as humans deal with and treat one another. God knew that for his people to have a good relationship with one another, they first needed to have that right relationship with God. God has to come first in our lives for everything else to work as it should. It was summarized perfectly by Jesus in Matthew 22:36-40. When Jesus answered the question asked of him, "Which is the greatest commandment in the law?" To which Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. All of the law and the prophets hang on these two commands. Amazing. Today we're going to be looking at the first six verses of Exodus 20. So let's start with the first two verses. So Exodus 20, the first two verses. And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. So verse 1 is telling us, telling us something very special, as it lets us know exactly where the following passage comes from and by whose authorities these commands, these words have been given. And God spoke all these words. The commands that are to follow are not from the imagination or the mouth of man. They are from God. They're also not a general guideline for all humans, should we feel so inclined to follow them. They are a direct and clear commands from God. Thou shalt not murder, for instance, isn't a guideline. It isn't a suggestion for us to live by if we kind of like feel like we want to do that. It's God's rule for us. All the commands are. There are no exceptions. We are like, not like the thief in our opening story who has set his own moral standards according to how we would like to do life. We have a higher authority to which we answer to. God's ways are perfect, and his laws are there not to inhibit us in life, but for our benefit. We see in verse 2 that God not only confirmed that he was the one who gave the commands, but he puts it beyond any doubt who he actually is. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. So let's check that a bit closer. The first statement here that God makes is, I am the Lord your God. This is the one true God speaking and making claim over all that he has created. I am the Lord your God. I'm him. I'm the one who created you. I'm the one through whom all things continue to exist. You don't believe in God? Well, that's up to you. That's a sin because I'm calling for your belief. But no matter what, I'm your God anyway. As Vice President George Bush represented the US at a funeral of former Soviet leader Leonid Brezhnev, Bush was deeply moved by a silent protest carried out by Brezhnev's widow. She stood motionless by the coffin until seconds before it was closed. Then, just as the soldiers touched the lid, Brezhnev's wife performed an act of great courage and hope, a gesture that must surely rank as one of the most profound acts of civil disobedience ever committed. She reached down and made a sign of the cross over her husband's chest. There in this citadel of secular atheistic power, the wife of the man who had run it all hoped that her husband was wrong. She hoped that there was another life and that that life was best represented by Jesus who died on the cross. And that same Jesus yet might have mercy on her husband. That was her hope. As I said before, our God says, I am the Lord your God. You don't believe in me? Like I said, that's up to you. That's a sin because I'm calling for your belief, but no matter what, I'm your God anyway. Just because you might say you don't believe in God, means absolutely nothing to me, to God. I exist beyond your belief or unbelief. Maybe you believe in some other gods or gods. I'm telling you now, you're wasting your time because I'm the only one who matters. I'm the only true hope in life that there is. And the wife of that Soviet leader knew it. And because I've made you, says God, I can claim you also. And you might wonder why I can do that or even think that it's, you might even think that it's unfair that I would make such a claim. Well, I've got news for you. I am the Lord your God. I am who I am. The second part of the opening sentence says, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Now, while God was speaking specifically to the people of Israel, his chosen people, he is also speaking to you and I. God identifies himself by his actions. I'm that God, you know, the one who defeated Pharaoh without even raising a sweat, saving you from the bounds of slavery. The 10 plagues of Egypt, that was me. The pillar of fire and the pillar of fog, yeah, that was me too. The parting of the Red Sea and the destruction of the Egyptian army, that was me. And he's also the God who has released us from the slavery of sin. He brought salvation to his chosen people of Israel, and he has done the same thing for you and I, for us, in bringing salvation to us through his son Jesus, who was God incarnate. Now, we can see the same thing with Jesus, can't we? Just like God identifies himself to his people and to those around through his actions, so too does Jesus. Jesus identifies himself through his actions. Every miracle that Jesus performed confirmed what he was preaching and identified him as God. Water to wine, feeding the 5,000 with a couple of loaves of bread and a few fish, commanding the seas to calm and the winds to cease, walking on water, casting out demons, healing the sick, raising the dead. And last but not least, dying for us, dying for you and I, being laid in a tomb, dead and buried, and then rising up from the dead on that third day. Witnessed by over 500 people, Jesus also identifies himself for you and I. What have you done with him, though? What have you done with Jesus? Out of love for his people, God first gave us the Ten Commandments, the law. Then out of love for his people, God gave his one and only begotten Son, and we gain salvation through grace. So now we know who we're talking about. Let's check out the first commandment. So Exodus 20 verse 3, you shall have no other gods before me. It seems fairly straightforward, doesn't it? He's saying, I'm it. When you pray, when you worship, I'm the only God listening, the only one who can hear you, the only one who can answer, the only one that can act in these situations. There can be no one else before me. I am the Alpha and the Omega in your life. None other can come close. I am God, and there shall be none before me. I will tolerate no other God above me, below me, beside me, no other God. This isn't a brag or a dictatorship. This isn't some kind of narcissist view or standing by an overzealous or overbearing God. This is truth in its purest form. This is fact beyond opinion, beyond science, beyond literature and poetry, beyond experience, beyond doubt. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. And yet, we so constantly do. But we'll come to that in time. The second commandment in verse 4 and the start of verse 5 says, you shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or to worship them. God will not compete with anything else. Nothing or no one else created can stand in his mighty stead. Even if you were to try and make an idol or an image representation of him, all attempts to do so would fall short and would be nothing more than a false image of a very real God. The daily devotion today in the Word tells the story of Hideyoshi Yoshi, a Japanese warlord who ruled over Japan in the late 1500s. He commissioned a colossal statue of Buddha for a shrine in Kyoto. It took 50,000 men 5 years to build it. But the work had scarcely been completed when the earthquake of 1596 brought the roof of the shrine crashing down and wrecked the statue. In a rage, Hideyoshi shot an arrow at the fallen colossus and yelled out, I put you here at great expense, he shouted, and you cannot even look after your own temple. In comparison, our God is omnipotent. That is, he is all-powerful. He has no limitations to his power other than the limitations that he has placed on himself. He is not a dead colossal man-made statue like this big Buddha or in our illustration, powerless to defend himself or his temple. He is the Lord of hosts. He is eternal. God is infinite or unlimited by time. He has always been and always will be. Revelation 4:8 says, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Our God is sovereign in every sense of the word, morally, transcendently, purposefully. His power is unlimited, and he has sovereign control over the affairs of nature and of history. Isaiah 45:9-19 and Romans 8:18-39 tell us this. God is the source of all creation, and all things come from and depend on God. Psalm 24:1 says, "The earth and its Lord is the Lord's and everything in it." Our God is immutable. He never changes. Omniscience, he's all-knowing. Omnipresence, that is, he is present in all places at all times. He is the Lord of hosts. "You shall have no other gods before me. You shall make for yourselves you shall not make for yourselves an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." So what's the revelation or the insight that these first two commandments kind of like give us into the character of God? Well, firstly, it tells us that God is a jealous God. You shall not make yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven or above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. But he's not jealous in the sense that he is jealous of us. Instead, he is jealous for us. It is a righteous jealousy because he is our God. It's like a marriage scenario. A husband and a wife is jealous for their spouse's attention and love. No one else should have it. No one else deserves it or even has a right to it in the way that a husband and a wife should care for and love one another. For a husband or a wife to love another in this way outside of the marriage is wrong, and the other spouse is rightly jealous of the love and attention that should be by rights theirs. And it's the same with God. He's the one who should receive our love and our worship. There should be nothing that comes between us and God. God is to be first and foremost. There should be nothing before him. God wants that number one spot in our life and is rightfully jealous for us as his people. There's no exceptions. You shall have no other gods before me. In fact, it is even more than just taking that number one spot. When God says, "You shall have no other gods before me," in marriage, we don't love our wife as number one, but then have other women who also we might also love in a similar way on the side. God is not saying, "Put me first and I don't care who you worship after me." He's not saying, "As long as I am the top God, I'm fine with you having as many other gods as you would like." He is saying, "You shall have no other gods before me." When God says this, he's actually saying, "You may not have any other gods in my place instead of me. You cannot have any other gods of equal standing alongside of me, and you cannot have any other gods with me, surplus to me, or in addition to me. I am God, full stop. There is no other. None can be compared or put up beside me. I am it, and I will tolerate no other." God is a holy and righteous God who upholds the truth and justice. God could let us go about our merry way believing in other gods, I suppose, putting other things in the place that only God deserves. But God values his creation. He values you and I, and he values truth. When God says, "You shall have no other gods before me," there is reason for it, because there are no other gods, only him. The confrontation for us here today is the fact that God knows the heart of humanity, and he knows that we're a people who are inclined to wander from the truth. God understood that he needed to spell out these first two commandments, because we are so inclined to wander from the truth. We see this happen with God's chosen people time and time again, don't we, throughout the Bible, as they kept turning their backs on God and relying on or worshipping other things that were just not worthy of their trust or worship. And while it's easy to point the finger at them and in wonder, in truth, we ourselves are no different. We also have a tendency to worship that which we should not worship. Now, you might think to yourself that I'm wrong in my assessment, but let's just do a quick check here. For those who are married or dating someone, who comes first? Your spouse or significant other, girlfriend or boyfriend, or God? Do you put God before them? For those of you who have kids, who comes first? Your kids or God? Does God really get that top spot? How about your business or work or your career? Does it take precedence over God? Maybe it's education or your social circle. How about your hobbies? If the opportunity arises and you have the choice between, for instance, church, your God, and your hobby, which wins out? How about your wealth and possessions? Do you hide them from God? Keep him at a distance from your hard-earned cash and possessions? What do you trust more? Do you trust more in your wealth and possessions, in other people, or in God? Would you be willing to give it all up for God? When we speak of creating and worshipping idols, do we have someone or something that we worship other than God? John Wimber once said, "Show me where you spend your time, money and energy, and I'll tell you what you worship." And this is the issue for us. God knew that this would be a problem. God wants, what he wants is real worship, genuine worship, worship where he is our number one priority, where there are no other idols to take our attention away from him. God wants true worship from his people, our undivided love and worship. Jesus warns us in Matthew 6:24 when he says, "No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." And yet we think that we can. Which master will you serve? King Solomon tells us in Proverbs 1:7 that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. So what do these commandments mean for us today? What is our instruction? What do we need to do or to do differently under the grace of our God? Well, I think our instruction's clear. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. We must ensure that we place God squarely on the throne of our lives. Our Lord has no equal. Every knee shall bow before Jesus. So there is no confusion when we bow the knee to Jesus. This is because Jesus Christ is the Son of God. What do we mean by this? This is to say that Jesus is God, come in human flesh. Just like John 1:1 tells us, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Jesus is not just a God amongst many gods, or the better option amongst a multitude of gods, but he is the one and only true God who came to earth incarnate, that is, in the form of a human, in the flesh. Further on in verse 14, it says, the Word became flesh, and made his dwelling amongst us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. We are called to give Jesus our very lives. When we call him our Lord and Savior, we're handing over the running of our lives to him. Jesus calls the shots, not us. We walk in his will, not anyone else's, not our own, Jesus's. You must give your complete and supreme allegiance to Jesus Christ, whom came from heaven, to him and to no one else. No one else deserves it. He is the one true God in Trinitarian form. Philippians 2:9-11 says, "Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." And this leads us to the last aspect of this sermon, being the promise. What is the promise that we have by adhering to this command? We see two things being stated here. The first is in the negative, or the second is in the positive. Let's look at it. "For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for their sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commands." The last part of verse 5 and verse 6 tells us that there are two consequences, or two results, depending on what you do. The first is a punishment, while the second is a blessing. It's interesting to compare the two, as they show the ultimate love and mercy of our God compared to his displeasure. The negative lasts until the third or fourth generation, while in comparison, the positive, being the love of God towards you and your family line, lasts for 1,000 generations. "For those who love me and keep my commands," says God. Well, how does this all work for the believer who, under the new covenant that has been forged by the blood of Jesus, being that we are saved by grace? Well, the grace that we have received, it doesn't nullify the commandments, and yet it sets us free. Ironically, if anything, it enhances them to another level. But by the power of the Holy Spirit, we are released from the law inscribed on tablets, because it is now written on our hearts in the blood of Jesus. These 10 commandments can only be truly followed with God's help through the power of the Holy Spirit, because of what Jesus has done for you and I on the cross. Jesus is our only hope for salvation. The law condemns us, while Jesus sets us free. Jesus is the only way to the Father. Forgiveness and eternal life can only come through him. Do you know Jesus? If not, now's the time. Let Jesus set you free from the bounds of sin and death. If you don't have Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then you have a problem, because you have the wrong God. Whatever it is that you have up there that is not Jesus is the wrong God. Your idol, whatever your idol is, whether it be your work, career, your relationships, your money, your possessions, whatever it is, whatever your idol is, it is spinning you a lie. My friend, to put it as simply as I can for you, it is either Jesus or bust. Jesus can set you free. Salvation is yours for the taking, but you're going to need to step up in faith and to ask him into your life to be your Lord and Savior. It will change your life as you walk the journey of life and eternal life with him. For those who are Christians, who follow Jesus, what a wonderful Lord you have. Let me encourage you to examine your life, though. Do you have any idols that you have built? Do you have any other gods before the one true God? The beauty of Christianity is that if this is the case, you can repent of this right here and now. You have been set free. And if you've found yourself bound again, you can be set free again from the chains that have been created, that you've created for yourself. By the grace of our God, sin has been defeated. Death has been crushed by Jesus. Walk again in the victory of Christ, free to truly worship the one true God. Let's pray. Lord, I just ask that you would speak to us, Lord. Lord, that your Holy Spirit would touch our hearts and touch our minds and our lives. Lord, we thank you for what Jesus has done. Lord, we thank you for the first two commands, Lord, that we have here, that you are the only God and there should be none before you, Lord, and that we are not to create idols and worship them. Lord, I just ask that for each of us, we would examine our own hearts and our own lives. And Lord, if there are any other gods, if there are any other idols that we have put before you, that we have there at all, that you would help us to remove them and that they would be gone for good, so that we can worship you, truly worship you. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' beautiful name. Amen.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And these are the days of your child, of famine and darkness and sore. We are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion until salvation comes. The days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide in the world. The labor is in young, yet declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee. And out of Zion to salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee. And out of Zion till salvation comes. Well,
that concludes our service for today. As I said before, it's wonderful that you could be with us today. This is one of the things, is a great opportunity to connect in this way. And whether you're a regular attender of our church, logging on and watching this, or whether you're watching it later on YouTube, or whether you're listening on the DVDs or the CDs, or even if you're capitalizing on the opportunity to use the online service and access our church in all places around the world, even far-flung places like Inverell, we send you a special welcome and a greeting for this week. Also, I'd like to send birthday wishes to the Cole family. Jessica Weber, Phil Cole's sister-in-law, is having a birthday today, as is Phil, and also Phil's wife, Jasmine, and Phil's son, Joseph, will be having, Jasmine and Joseph will be having their birthdays later this week. So that concludes the service. As I said, we pray that you have a good week, and may God bless you, and we'll see you again next week. Goodbye.